Hello, good afternoon, everybody, and trust you all are doing good. I am Eze Samuel Chinonso, the founder of Smart School. I welcome you to the Smart School Growth Academy. This year's edition, we have so many professionals in the education field who are going to speak to us on different topics, on different subjects, on school growth, on how to handle parents, and everything you need to know about how to grow your school. That's what we are here to do. So if you can hear me on the comment section, do well to notify on the comment section that you can hear me properly. If you cannot hear me properly, you can also notify us on the comment section that you cannot hear us. Once again, welcome to the Smart School Growth Academy, the June edition. This year's edition, we are treating on a topic that says thriving in ever-changing world of education. Having seen in the previous years that things grow fast, since changes, AI comes in, different technology comes in, different policies comes in, then how then do we, the educators, have to thrive? How can we navigate our way through these changes, through these challenges that are facing us, through these policies that we are not being consulted on before making? How can we navigate our ways in the little way we can do in our environment? All right, so we have the first speaker on the stage. He's going to speak on a topic that you would like to hear. We have Mr. Steven on the stage.
Yes, good afternoon.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. Welcome to the stage. I want to appreciate you for honoring our invitation to speak on our platform today. Thank you very much, sir, for all you do.
Yes, you are welcome. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Thank you.
All right, sir. Thank you very much. Mr. Steven is going to speak on school population growth magnet technique. So that is the topic he's going to teach this afternoon, on how to grow your school, the techniques you need to implement in your school in order to grow your school. All right, so Mr. Steven, you can do justice to the topic in the next few minutes.
Okay, I'm so sorry. I think the network from my home is not really working as expected. But all the same, please let's quickly start. Now, the first question that I want to ask you as a school owner and, you know, the stakeholders in school business, education at large, I want to ask you that what exactly do we think is the greatest need, all right, at this particular time in our education system, in our school setup? What is the greatest need? Because everybody seems to be doing the same thing, okay? What you find in this school is what you find in another school. There are just few of, you know, schools around that are doing something different. So what exactly is our need? Because the essence of having school, all right, is to enhance the process of integrating individual, the children that you have in your school, into the society in a way that they will be beneficiary to themselves and then the society at large. So what exactly do we need? Everyone is, following a particular line of curriculum. Everyone is following a pattern of, teaching. There are so many things that, is happening in the sector that seems as we don't even have a standard. But you see, the question is that we need to do, because when we're talking about school growth, right, the system has to be scrutinized, and then you have to be sure of what you are putting on the table that is bringing people to your school. Bringing people to your school is one work. Sustaining and maintaining them in your school is another work. There is a level where you will get to that you don't actually need to do all the publicity that you are doing now. It goes to another level entirely, because when you focus on what is needed, you will attract the kind of people or a class of your a class of the society that can, you know, put your school in a place where they will appreciate what exactly you are putting on the table. So what exactly is the greatest need in our education sector? What is it that is lacking in our school that will, you know, that you will effortlessly, you know, leverage on to populate your school? I see a lot of things happen at this time. I see school owners looking for ways to just draw attention of people, you know, to their school. This is third term, and then we're going into our first term. We're going into the admission season. Everyone wants to do a show that will bring people, you know, just to attract people. But you see, are you really, you know, you don't attract them and then you get scared of losing them. What is the strategies that you are putting in place? What is the method that you are putting in place to retain them and maintain them, all right, to the point where they begin to refer you? So I'm just going to talk about one need that I want everyone listening to me, all right, to focus on. It's not a popular thing in our school setting. It's not the focus now. But I tell you that this secret is going to grow your school, all right, beyond what you ever imagined. And what is that thing? You see, there is something that is missing in our schools. There is something that is that if you begin to focus on it, all right, it's enough. It is enough to project your school even to the international standard, because these are the things that is used, all right, that can make you know, your school to be populated as what you want it. And that need is research. You see, research is a big word, all right, and it's something that is missing in our school. We don't have a driving system that, you know, scrutinize a concept, dissect a particular subject, knowing the new things that is in that particular thing, or the disruption that has happened. What I'm saying in the essence is that our teachers are not doing research on what they are teaching, and school owners are not. Do not even know. Some school owners do not know how to even go about this. You don't know how to, you know, to make your teachers to research and then go to class with something that is globally reckoned and 21st century oriented. We have schools that we are running, and all that we do is to confine our studies and our classroom experience to the dictate of the scheme of work that is given by the state, or the federal, or whichever one that you are using, and then, you know, subject yourself to, you know, the dictate of the textbook. We are not going to make any change, and we are not going to bring any significant development in our school. We might be able to attract the numbers, but we might not be able to effectively impact on this coming generation what is needed. The question is that, what kind of future are you preparing the children in your school for? The future you are preparing them for, it's a future that you should sit down as a school owner or administrator to envision and see. That is what will now influence whatsoever that your teachers are doing. Now, let me tell you this thing. It's important for you to realize that without you influencing your teachers, without you training your teachers, without you providing certain infrastructures in your school that can prepare these children for the future that is waiting for them, or permit me to say, the future that has already arrived, all right? In order to prepare them for this and not make them to be irrelevant in that future, then we need to do the needful. You see, parents will troop into your school when they know that your school is a school to reckon with when it comes to thinking about their children's future It's a school that has provided what is needed. It's not just doing mathematics and English. There are a lot of disruption in banking industry. There are a lot of disruption in our economic. There are a lot of disruption in our military, in our security. Okay, in the last 2 decades, you don't know anything about terrorism. Nobody knows things about terrorism. Okay, a lot of things are happening today that we need to begin to deploy technology for. We need to begin to look beyond just the knowledge of mathematics and English. So many things are happening in the banking industry that will, in the next 10 years, there will be significant change. Now, the question is that what are you preparing these children in your school for? If your teachers will go to class with the dictate of the scheme of work, with the dictate of, the textbook, and just go and then, just deliver. And what is there, okay, you will agree with me that what is in that curriculum that you are using is not even relevant to what these children will need in their future. We need children that go home and ask their parents questions that challenge the parents' intellectual capacity. We need schools that are innovative enough that on their school bill, they are not charging parents for ICT any longer. Because I asked the question, why, when you are charging parents for ICT facility in your school, what else will you be doing? And you said you are running a 21st century teaching content school, and then you are charging parents for ICT. What exactly should be in your school? Should be in your class, if not for ICT. So these are the questions that I want you to answer. The greatest need of our education, the greatest need of our school, is far beyond what we are covering right now. And it's important that we should understand that we are preparing the children, all right, for the future that is more complicated. The future that is more than what we have now. It takes us to make a step further in the context that we have developed in our school and in what we want to achieve with the life of these children. With the job of the future is completely different from the work of the future. The work of the future is completely different from the profession of the future. You see, medical doctors will remain medical doctors. Lawyers will remain lawyers. Bankers will remain bankers. But the mode of the operations will be changed entirely. The question is that if you say that you are running a school, all right, and then you want children to come to your school, you want your school to be populated, the question is that what exactly do you want to achieve with it, irrespective of the size of your school? I was speaking to some school owners on our platform recently, and I told them that, listen, it's important that you increase the population of your school. Yes, very beautiful. It's good that you do all these things. But you see, I want you to know that naming your school a Montessori school or running a British blended Nigerian curriculum is not going to give you what you need. Somebody sat down, compared the British curriculum and Nigerian curriculum together and blended. What exactly do we call blending? It's about uprooting from this and then uproot from this and bring it to the middle, okay, and make it a whole. Now, the question is that somebody sat down, all right, and built that. So what are you building in your school? What are you sitting to do in your school? I have worked with several schools. And the moment I come into your school, the first thing that I collapse is your teaching content. Because all this state curriculum and state scheme, they're just going to give you an expired content. They will never develop your school. The essence of having a school in the first place, before you talk about populating that school, is to develop the human capacity of the nation. And if that is your focus, then you begin to look at international standard, okay? And then when you begin to look at that international standard, the next stop for you is that you begin to look at those who dictate the experience in your class, your teachers. How are you doing, or what are you doing to develop the capacity of your teachers? Before we talk about the capacity of the teachers, I talk about the capacity of the school owners. The school owners, the administrators, what exactly do you have that stands you out as a person? What do you know? How many, I mean, how much of exposure do you have? Okay, it's important that we look at these areas, okay, and then begin to ask ourselves questions. And the question is that, look, what is the need? What exactly do I come here to fill? Because before you start thinking of growth, let me tell you something. When parents know that your school is the school for the future, that is, the children in your school, okay, are not going to learn the arithmetic, the mathematics, or English alone. They know that when they enroll their children in your school, the future is guaranteed. That is, the children in your school, all right, we have an enviable future by the system that you have created, the content of your classroom experience, the capacity of your teachers. And then, you see, to grow your school will become effortlessly, because, you see, you prepare the children for the future. It's important to know that. I have here that I just want to, you know, I have something written down there that I want to read to you. I said, populating your school will become effortless when parents know you stand for the long-term purpose of their children's education and not just for the short-term transactional relationship you both have now. It's not just that you are looking for people to come into your school so that they can bring money into your school. But you see, as you entered into the new session, okay, as you entered into the new session, I want you to know that, you see, you have a burden, you have a responsibility. It's not just about the timely subscription that the parents make in your school that should keep you alive, that should keep your school alive. It's all about what they are getting from that subscription and the essence of having your school. And I've mentioned it. Make this thing to be part of your research. And that is where technology comes in. That is where technology comes in. I remember, I know that this platform that we are using, the organizer of this platform, is into school website and building and doing all of how to enhance the technological, the ICT base of a school. That's a very beautiful one. It's not something that we should debate about. It's not something that we should be thinking whether we should do it or not. Everyone on this platform should ask and make inquiry and see how you can equip your school in a way that your teachers can conveniently make research about their subject, about their concept, about their topics, before going into the class to understand the disruptions, to understand the development, to understand the change that has taken place in the concepts that they are going to the class to teach. Let me tell you, those that will advertise your school beyond the banner, the online publicity, and what have you, the parents, your parents are the greatest marketers that you have. The greatest marketers in your school, they are your parents. When your parents begin to announce your school outside, that is when you have hit it. Because that is when people trust referrer. People trust brands that are referred. So when parents begin to, post content on their platform, post it on their social media, their colleagues in their offices, text their neighbors and family friends. It is because it's different. And what exactly is this experience? Let me ask you. All right? The experience is not that nobody is going to refer you meeting their expectations, because their expectation is not impressing them. They have that expectations already. But you see, beat the expectations of your customers to become your marketers. Beat the expectations of your catchment environment, and then to grow your school will become effortlessly. I'm telling you the truth. I've been doing this business as a school growth consultant for quite a number of years now. For almost 7 years, I've been walking around all around Nigeria, from east to west to the north, and we have a platform of over 5,000 school owners on WhatsApp alone. On WhatsApp alone, we're not talking about other platforms like Facebook, Telegram and Instagram and stuff. We're not even going there, just on WhatsApp alone. So I know what it takes. I've practically, I've done this that I'm teaching you this afternoon on this platform now. I've done it in several places. I've collaborated as a consultant for some schools, all around, and we have done it severally. And I can tell you that strategy that works is a result-oriented return investment. If you do it, that is what I put up to you right now. It will sustain your standard. It will build, a good reputation for you in the committee of schools in your neighborhood. When your classroom experience is full, is from research. The teachers are not just going into class. The teachers are well equipped. They have studied, and this is why I want to say to you that if you are still disturbing and you are still shouting on your teachers when they complain that they don't have data on their phone or they can't use their phone for research, it's a fault from you. It's a fault from you because of the capacity to develop it to that point that the children in your school are not going to be disadvantaged from what they are entitled for. It's important to do this, all right? So I believe that you understand that the greatest need for our population growth, the greatest needs of our school, okay, is from primary to secondary, even our university, is research. Research is lost. Research is lost. And if you can do this, if you can make this to happen, you will be surprised at the result.
All right, I think Mr. Steven is having some issues with his network. He's going to join us right back. Please, if you are getting value from what you are learning, just drop something on the comment box. Let me see what you are dropping. Drop the greatest thing, one of the things that you have picked from this lesson. Mr. Steven is going to come back in a few minutes. What is the greatest thing? What is the main thing you are picking from this lesson? Drop it on the comment section. Drop it on the comment section. What is the number one thing that you have picked from this lesson? Drop it on the comment section. I'm waiting. Drop what you have gotten from this lesson on the comment section. Drop what you have learned from this section on the comment box. What is that thing that you have picked up from this lesson that will make you to grow your school? I have a few number of things that I've written here, close to 3 pages. All right, one of the things is this. It asks a question, the school you're operating now, what is the need? What problem are you trying to solve? So if your school is not solving a problem, which means you're not running a profitable school that will attract the type of parents you need. So your school should solve a problem. That's one of the points that I picked out from his section. And he's right back. Let's welcome Mr. Steven again.
Okay, sorry. I told you my network is just working as But I was just about rounding up my question. I think the point has been made, okay? School owners should there's something about this that is important. That it should be only the only way to and have people that can pay for what we want to have. If one of the small content is led by a time to expand a solid strand, that is, I know those things are important. You know, school fees to come in, parents must. They want to, you know, get in some money, they want to do this, but you see, why don't you form a committee in your school to sit down and, you know, look at the, what you are teaching, the model of your teaching content, your curriculum, the scheme of what you are using, what exactly is the content?
I think Mr. Steven is still having some issue with network, and we sincerely apologize for that inconvenience. Mr. Steven, I don't know, your mic is cracking, and can you just log out and log in again? Let's see if it will be fixed. All right, I'm receiving some messages from the comment section. All right, let me read some of them. Number one says, I agree with Mr. Steven that our teachers should be well equipped to teach and prepare the children for the future. That is number one thing that will drive population to your school. The teachers should be equipped. We should teach the future, not the past. All right, number two person says something here. okay, the greatest advertiser to one's growth in school is the parents. That's a very powerful statement. That's a very powerful statement. The greatest advertiser for your school. I wrote it this way. Your billboard, your signboard, your flyers, and so on and so forth. Even after signing up with Smart School to develop your website, to do all these things, if you're not dishing out content, if you're not teaching the future, if you're not doing any of these, you are wasting resources. You are wasting your time, right? One of the greatest advertisers of your school are the parents. All right. I don't know, Mr. Steven, are you still? Okay, Mr. Steven is back. All right, continue, sir. I think, Mr. Steven, are you still with us? All right, let me give Mr. Steven a little time for him to fix his microphone, for him to fix his network. Okay, another person says something here. Okay, let me read the last one. What is missing? I think what she wants to say is what is missing in school that is affecting population to grow is mostly, number one, research. Number one is research. The teachers, the school owners fail to research on latest trend. You are hearing about AI, you are hearing about different innovations, you are hearing about different technological tools, you are hearing about different curriculum, different things, but your school is still back. Your school is still at the 19th century method of teaching. What are you doing? Have to do research, have to research and incorporate the latest trend in your school system, in your academics, in whatever you are doing in your school, the way you manage your school, the teachers, the parents. You have to inculcate to them the latest trend. Don't be afraid to introduce new things in school. Don't be afraid. Once parents understand the things you want to introduce, the benefits, and also understand and portray it to the future, you'll be able to understand and key into what you are doing. I have a lot of people that are complaining about parents not accepting this. You cannot introduce a new thing when you are not working on the fundamental thing. If the students are not going through the content you are dishing out to them on from Monday to Friday, even some schools do have some weekdays classes. If the students are not growing well in what you are teaching them, if you introduce new things, if you introduce new innovation, they are still going to keep against it. All right, I think Mr. Steven is back. Let's go back to Mr. Steven so I can see. Do justice to the topic. All right, as you are waiting for him, okay, he has logged out. As you are waiting for him, if you have any question that you want to ask Mr. Steven before he leaves the stage in the next few minutes, please drop it in the comment section. I have so many questions to ask him, but we also need your question. Also, drop your question on the comment section. What are you confused? What do you want to implement your school that you are confused on taking the step? What is that number one thing that you want to do that is affecting your school? Drop into the comment section so Mr. Steven will join us right back and answer those questions within the next few minutes. All right, drop your question. Drop your question. What is the number one thing that is affecting your school that you would like Mr. Steven to help you to navigate through on school population growth magnet? What is the number one thing that is affecting your school? Drop it on the comment section. but drop it on the comment section. I think Mr. Steven is already, she's joining us back. Right, let's wait for him. He's joining us back. Let him log out. I think he has some network issue. Has some network issue from his own end. This is still one of the quotes that I like so much, that I love so much from the greatest advertiser to once good in school is the parents. The parents is one of the greatest advertisers for your school. And let me be sharing some of the few things that I noted down from my own end. I said number one is I think Mr. Steven is back. Remember, we are still treating on school population growth magnet techniques. So he just gave us one for this section. So I think Mr. Steven is back. All right, sir. Welcome back, sir.
Okay, yeah.
All right, just round off so that we can ask. There are a few questions that we would like to ask you before you leave the state. So, go on, sir.
Okay. What I said before the network, when it comes to, you know, the main core of this business, which is yes, it's a business, you need to make money. Yeah. But you see, what is more important, why, you know, I said that all the things that you are using in your school, especially your curriculum and your scheme, all right, I work on them. Okay, put creativity. Creativity is one of the things that, you know. If I have time today, I will have given talk more about from research. Another thing that is not in our school is creativity. It's not in our teachers. And don't expect that the university that we have today or the college of education that we have today will give you or will fortify the teachers that are coming to teach in your school with all these things. You will have to be the one to develop it in your school. As a matter of fact, not only the children you are training in your school, they are also training the teachers. Okay, that is what your school should be. It surprised me sometimes when you see teachers, you know, putting from one school to another, and then you ask during an interview, how many trainings have you attended? And, you know, they can't say anyone. And when they attend the trainings, is it the trainings that, you know, that actually points to things that you need in your school? Do you need the content that the consultant or whoever that is coming to train you, is that what you need now? You see, all these things, you must sit down and ask yourself this question. You are investing into this, you are putting on structures, you are inviting consultants and facilitators to come and train your teacher. If those things the things that you need? Okay, do you need them? So you see, creativity is not in our classroom. Everyone is just so relaxed. The school owner is shouting on the things that he or she cannot say, that this is what is needed. Okay, but I'm telling you today, if you can put those two things that I've mentioned here, all right, together. Number one, I mentioned that the greatest need of your school, all right, is research. Number two, all right, I mentioned now that creativity. Creativity will not come, okay, if your teachers are not exposed. If your teachers do not see wide, and the only way to make this is to make technology to be you know, something sustained in your school, irrespective of the investment, it's worth it. Okay, it's worth it. And then, look at the content of what you have in your class. Okay, the content of what you have in your class, look at it and see a way, all right, to influence it where, you know, you can actually, begin to look at ways through which it can be tailored to what you want. When all these things are put together, I can tell you from the beginning of the session, the population will never reduce. I have a school that when we were about to enter into second term, they had more than 20, pupils coming to their school. It's unusual that you have that kind of thing in second term. And we had people that came to make inquiries and promise that this term, this new session, they are coming in. When your school is the school for the future, people will come to you. So that's it. I don't know if you have any questions.
All right, there's no, sorry, my mic was muted. There's no question on the comment section, but I have some few questions that I would like to ask you that I noted down while you are teaching. During your teaching, you say something about if these teachers that is exhausted or they don't have microphone. Can you hear me, sir? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? All right. In one previous, you say something about if your teacher's data is exhausted and, okay. Let's just wait for him to fix his microphone. He says something about if your teacher's data is exhausted, is the school fault? I think he's still going to come back to address that question. And if he's not able to join us back, then it will be happening in the group chat on the WhatsApp platform. In case if you are not in the group chat, please do well to register for this event and we'll be redirected to the training WhatsApp platform. All right, we have the second speaker. She's already seated and waiting for us. Okay, Mr. Steven is back. All right, sir, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now, sir? All right, I think we have to move on to the next speaker since Mr. Steven is not hearing us. Okay, sir, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now, sir? Can you hear me now, sir? Okay, I think we are going to jump your section. I think we are going to jump your section and start over next time. All right. Okay, if you have, just like I said, if you are not in the WhatsApp platform, do well to register and join us in the WhatsApp platform. He's still going to come back in the WhatsApp platform to educate us on this school population magnet techniques. He talked about research, he talked about creativity. two things that are missing in our current school system. Number one is research. We fail to do research. And number two is innovative creativity. That is creativity, bringing up new ideas, changing new things, changing the old things to new, implementing new policies, implementing new curriculum, and so on and so forth. So that is one of the things here. Okay. One person asks if teacher's data is exhausted, is it the school fault? I think Mr. Steven has a very good answer for that, but network is affecting us currently now. So I think if you are in the WhatsApp platform, you are still going to invite him back in the WhatsApp platform to answer all these questions that we just noted down. All you need to do is to drop it on the WhatsApp, on the comment section. Then after one of us is going to check through and join and draft out the questions. I have said before, if you're not in the WhatsApp platform, either you did not register for the event or you did not wait for you to be redirected to the event. If you have registered for the event, then hold on. We are still going to send out an invitation mail to your email address to redirect you to the WhatsApp platform. All right, I think we are going to move to the next speaker, but let me verify if she is ready. All right. We have our next speaker, Mrs. We have the next speaker, Estina Ayode. Estina Ayode, she's going to speak on understanding and supporting the unique needs of individual students. Mr. Steven talked about growing your school population. Then the next speaker is going to speak on how you can understand, how to understand or understanding the unique needs of individual students, of individual children. Mr. Steven made reference on changing things, if your curriculum is solving a problem or not. So the next speaker is going to talk on how you can understand and support the unique need of individual students. In a school, in a mixed classroom, we have so many people, we have so many students with different needs. So Mrs. Ayode is going to fix and educate us on how we can navigate our way and be successful in applying the strategies. All right, so let's make welcome Mrs. Ayode to this podium.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
All right, thank you so much for giving me this platform, for this opportunity, and I'm very, very happy. I discovered you were having it a little bit difficult to call my name. My name is Anita Ayode.
Okay, Anita.
That's the name.
All right.
Ayode. All right, then. Once again, I say thank you for the opportunity. Well, you actually asked me to speak about one of the area of my passion. Passion in the sense that for over 20-something years of running the school business, from being a teacher, you know, then becoming an head of school, and then now a consultant and a director with my own school. I discovered that most times our children, learners come into our schools, into our classroom with different strengths. And what I mean by strength is they would never be able to learn from you until you are able to actually use the method that is actually very comfortable for them to learn from. So if you research about it, we have 9 learning styles, 9 basic learning styles, which includes music learners, dancers, bodily learners, interpersonal and intrapersonal, nature learners, you know, and they're just 9. What that simply means is that as a teacher, when you understand these learning styles, it will affect how you prepare your platform to teach the children. Let's take, for example, I actually sent some pictures to you. I don't know, maybe you'll be able to help me to hear those pictures. I sent some pictures to you already that I would have loved to use for my presentation. Are you hearing me? Am I loud enough? Hello? Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, ma'am. We can hear you.
Okay, good. So when children come into your classroom with all of these needs, these strengths, then you must be able to structure your curriculum delivery to suit their strength. Okay, so let's take, for example, children that are coming into your classroom with a music strength. There is nothing you want to teach them. You have to put in music so that they can understand it. And that is why, for me, when I'm teaching the children how to write numbers and words, I just don't go straight to ask them to start cramming the spelling to say O-N-E-1, T-W-O-2. No, I won't do that. I'll first of all try to introduce them to visual. They watch a whole lot of video presenting that spelling to them. And then after that, I get them to sing the song. O-N-E is number one, T-W-O number two, T-H-R-E-E number three, F-O-U-R number four, F-I-V-E number five. And then you discover that when you do that, children begin to learn same topic with different styles. Those who can't cram, who are not logical learners, they'll be able to sing. Those who can sing, who are visual learners, they'll be able to watch the video. And that is all about the new education, the new school. So gone are those days that all that teachers want to do is to go to the classroom and begin to write on the board and start asking the children to copy notes and stuff like that. So it is very, very important for us to begin to look at it from that angle. So when I teach teaching skill, for example, and I'm helping practitioners on curriculum delivery, I'm always very practical about it, because children would always come into your classroom with different strengths, and your curriculum delivery must be able to meet each person's need. So that at the end of the day, no child is actually left out in your classroom. So this is the age where we can have teachers without phone. We can have teachers without data and internet. We can't. Any teacher that is going to be successful in this world that we are in now must be technology inclined and must be a researcher. So you cannot just want to walk into the classroom to teach children and you feel you'll be able to make good results. You won't be able to make such results. So those pictures I sent to you are what we call the exit points. The exit point simply means when we give children the opportunity to reflect over the information and knowledge that they are being given, beyond copy notes, beyond just listening to the teachers, but now being part of their own learning. So assuming you're able to show me those pictures now, you will see that the children are actually learning about ladybug in that picture. And the exit point, which is a reflection center, is when the children now have opportunity to dress up like ladybug and they begin to talk about ladybug. They begin to share different facts about ladybugs. So that is the new age education. That is the new age school. So when you're talking about the needs of students, the first thing that every practitioner must research on is to go and learn about the nine learning styles. If you have your jotter with you, I will want you to write that down. The nine learning styles that children would always bring into our classroom. And the moment you're able to now structure the whole of your curriculum to meet the need of those children, I told you about musical, you're able to bring music into whatever you're teaching them. I told you about visual, you're able to bring a video, You're able to cut out things, pictures for them to see. I talked about nature. You're able to take them out of the classroom to learn around nature. Then you will discover at the end of the day that the children are learning and they enjoy school. It's just no longer a boring setting. And you know, one powerful thing that everyone who is in the education sector must know at this time is that the world has completely changed. What we call education some years ago is not really what education is all about now. So I tell people that now in this realm that we are, it's not going to be about passing exams. I don't know, maybe, you know, somebody is beginning to see the reality of that. Okay, now let me share something with you. I kept telling my teachers that when you are teaching children, try as much as possible not to teach them, you know, in a traditional way. I'm always saying that. And I keep telling my teachers that when you're working with children, don't teach them based on the fact that you just want them to pass exams. Passing exams is not a difficult thing. It's such a very, very easy thing that can happen to anyone. What do I mean? You can get children to pass common entrance within 4 months. And I've proven that over and over again in different places and in different locations. You can get children to pass common entrance easily, very, very easily. All you need to do is to get all the past questions. When you get all the past questions, get them to practice over and over again. And before you know it, they will pass common entrance. But getting children to be relevant in life and be able to deliver as an adult is what is not always an easy thing. And our education must be able to do that. And that is why I'm so excited about this discussion, where we're beginning to talk about how do we make sure that every child in our school, in our classroom, every child is learning, and no child is considered a dullard because they are not having the same learning style like other children. So we must be able to do that with our children. So this is the point. If your school in this age is going to be very successful, and the parents will keep, you know, referring their friends to come, and then you have growth and you have increase, then you must be ready to help your teachers to take teaching beyond the board, beyond writing on the board for the children. You must be able to push your teachers to do more than getting children to copy notes, than getting children to write in their exercise books without being part of their own learning, engaging them and giving them opportunity. The world is a very small world now. I know you understand what is happening to everybody now. A whole lot of Africans are relocating and we're finding ourselves in another part of the world. How prepared are we for this new world we're talking about? Well, I appreciate the fact that in the developed world, they are so particular about training and retraining. So, of course, they are not going to fix you in your class just anyhow. But you see, it's easier if you already have an understanding of what I'm talking about and then you find yourself in another country. The little training they're going to give to you, you'll be able to fit in because already your mind is already shifted and you have an understanding of what they are making a demand on you to become as a teacher in their classroom. So it is very, very important for us as educators, very important for us as school owners, school consultants, curriculum managers, or whoever we are in the school environment to make sure that our teachers are not traditional teachers. They are teachers who understand that children will come into their classroom with different needs, able to prepare their curriculum delivery to suit and to meet the needs of those children. I don't know, maybe I'm communicating this evening. Are we there? Is my voice loud enough? Hello?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you properly, ma'am. You are fully.
Okay, you are hearing me properly. Okay, good. So when, for my topic that is talking about meeting the different needs of learners in our classroom, what do I mean? That means in a typical classroom of this century, of this age, the Generation Z classroom, that classroom cannot be a classroom that we just have whiteboard alone. There must be something that will work with the visual learners. It might be the interactive board. It might be the television. It might be, you know, but your classroom must be equipped to meet different learners' need. The classroom must be equipped. The owner of a school must know that every child who comes into the classroom with different needs must be able to get out of the classroom equipped, knowledgeable, great understanding, and have skills. And I mean skills. That is when the subject or whatever topic we're teaching the children is engaging. The children use their brain. We get them to think. We get them to use their hands. We get them to relate. Their social skill is being developed. Their communication skill is being developed. And that is why it is very important for us to have curriculum managers in our school. And not just having curriculum managers who will not only be on the writing path, but will be ready to have constant meeting with teachers after going through their plan on how they plan to deliver the topic or whatever. This curriculum manager will have to sit with the teachers, give them ideas, do a web meeting with them, generate ideas with them, help them to make resources available that will make their teaching robust and productive. Very, very important. So if our school is really going to be schools that would have results, then it is very important for us to begin to consider those things that I've said this evening. We shouldn't just take it for granted. I was so excited when I heard the other speaker speaking. I learned a lot from him. And then he was talking about school population and stuff like that. And he talked about research. And you know, that really got me thinking, really, because most schools now don't understand that they are serving Generation Z parent. And from the name, the Gen Z parent, you would understand that I'm talking about almost the end time parent. And you need to research about them, try to get how they think, their belief system, their dressing, their priorities, and so many things you need to research about them so that you'll be giving them exactly what they want. Let me give you one of the characteristics of the Generation Z parent. They love beautiful places. If your school is actually going to keep growing and be a good school, for example, then one thing you must know is that your curriculum must meet the needs of the children. But apart from meeting the needs of the children, Generation Z parents want their children to come back to them at home and they can engage each other in what I call intelligent discussion. The Generation Z parents won't be asking their children to tell them Lagos State, Ikeja, Abia State, Uyo. That's not what the Generation Z parent is going to be asking their children when they have opportunity to bond with them. They're going to be expecting to have discussion with them on dinosaurs, to have discussion with them on space. They want their children to talk to them about, you know, relevant issues around the world. They want their children to come up and ask them what is happening in the UK presently, who is the new king. You know, they want to engage them in good thinking. So that means that traditional ways would not really work with the Generation Z parents in curriculum delivery. So our schools must begin to have a very deep understanding about what the parents of this generation would be looking out for in their children. They want their children to be able to use the computer right from year one, year two, if possible, FS4. Foundation stage. The Generation Z just want something quite completely different from what the Generation W or Generation Y would be expecting. You would agree with me that during my time and your time, what our parents expect us to come home to tell them that we are learning It's not what our children are telling us now that they are learning in schools. So it is very important for us to go check our curriculum. I'm so passionate about the curriculum. In fact, sometimes I laugh and I call myself the curriculum master, because I've written over, if not about 10 different curriculums. I wrote an entrepreneur curriculum. I wrote an emotional curriculum. I've written a whole lot because, you know, I just kept looking at what the need of this present world is all about and how our schools will be able to meet that need in our children. This time, there are some things that if you don't know, even your soft skills, is much more important now than knowing your mathematics. If you know your cognitive, you know your math, you know your English, but your social skill is poor, you can't say hello to people, you can't praise people, you can't appreciate people, you're always in competition, you have a scarcity thinking, your abundance thinking is slim, then success is going to be very far from you. So our curriculum should be teaching our children how to be nice to people, how to be the first to say hello in a gathering, how to smile, how never to want to bully people, never to body shame people. Our curriculum should be looking at handling such issues for our children in this age, if our schools are going to be relevant, if our schools are going to solve problems. So let me quickly drop this bombshell I'm always dropping for school owners. You need to ask yourself, those parents in your school now, how old are they? If your school is going to keep growing, how old are those parents? Most times, if your school has a provision to accommodate parents that the child or their children in your school is their first child and second child at a particular age, and you're able to satisfy their needs, they are happy, I can assure you that those parents will keep bringing their circle. But the moment your school is too a cake for such parents to want to stay, then that may just mean that your school has a lifespan that is very short. Very, very short. And that is why we need to seriously look into some of those points that I've actually dropped today. We need to get our practitioners to have great exposure beyond note copying, to take curriculum delivery to the realm of engaging the children and giving them sessions of reflection and connecting what they are learning to their real world. I think that really is going to help our education system in Nigeria. And I know that sometimes some of the things that remains the fear for both school owners, school leaders, curriculum managers, and the teachers themselves is always about economy, where the question of how do I get data, how do I buy, and stuff like that. But this is always my answer when I come in contact with practitioners and school educators. I say, the same way we can't ask question about how do I get food to eat, somehow you just look for a way to make sure that you are eating. It's the same way you have to think about data. It's the same way you have to think about having resources to work with children. It's exactly the same way. If our schools are going to remain relevant, not just in Africa, but around the globe. Very, very important. All right. I don't know, maybe there is any question or somebody just want to engage me and then I can take that part and be able to then speak to us directly. Thank you so much for having me.
All right. Thank you very much, Ma, for the wonderful section you just delivered here now. All right, I have some few questions that I jotted down while you were teaching. Number one is, in a classroom where there are mixed students, let me say we have a slow learner and we have a fast learner, that's the backward student and the fastward student. How can a teacher break down herself in order to accommodate all the students and help them to push forward in learning?
All right. Now, let me quickly say something about the EYFS curriculum, which is actually the British curriculum, the RIO curriculum, which is actually the American curriculum, the Estia curriculum, which is actually the Scotland curriculum, of course, the Nigerian curriculum, which, of course, I've not been able to find a way to really exploit like I've exploited other curriculum. Every of this curriculum, Montessori curriculum, every of this curriculum is always telling us that no child is actually backward. No child is a slow learner. What they try to inject into the mind of every practitioner that will be working with children is to add the mindset that every child is actually going to learn at their pace, meaning that the difference, you know, because whatever we call a thing affects the way we relate with that thing. When we call our children or our learners slow learners, backward learners, or whatever other name we want to give them, we relate with them like that too. And then our patience to want to guide them through their milestone period, which can never be the same as every other person. That's why we have the inclusive in early years education. So when we have an understanding that every child will learn at their pace, then it gives us that patience to be able to say, oh, it doesn't really matter. Adewale is going to get it. Adewale may not get what I'm teaching on Monday. He might not get it on Tuesday. But by Wednesday, he should be catching up. By Thursday, he has a better understanding of what I'm doing. And then by Friday, he's almost there. Like Mary, who has all the understanding on Monday. And, you know, every child learns at this pace we're talking about based on so many factors, based on their temperament. Sanguines, choleric, are fast learners. Children who come from a particular level of success, less faster, because right from pregnancy, they've been feeding them with things that makes their brain to be highly intelligent and be able to process information. So when we have this deep understanding that we know that no child is actually a slow learner or a backward learner. They are just going to learn at their own pace. And then the practitioner would have to give them that opportunity to learn at their own pace. So my answer to that question is just get teachers, practitioners, get them to have better understanding about the learners they are working with and their patience. And the way they relate with those children is actually going to be beautiful and they would have better result with them.
All right. Thank you very much, ma, for doing justice to this question. But one of the issues that so many teachers that do encounter is school owners trying to force the teachers in order to cover the curriculum for that's the scheme of work for the whole term. Let me say we have 12 weeks, 13 weeks to study, and a teacher is trying to accommodate every student in order to teach, in order for everybody to learn one part. Let me say I'm talking about the nine planets, and some of the students have learned it all, why some have not yet. How can the teacher when he or she is being persuaded by the school owner to move forward in order to cover up the curriculum, in order to cover up the scheme of work for that particular term, how can the teacher wage down such persuasion? And I also have one of the questions here is that, well, just answer this one, then move on to the next question.
Okay, let me quickly ask this question or even say this. I think if your school owner is pushing teachers to cover up this, to cover up that, is because maybe the school owner herself don't even have a very deep understanding about the reality of our education in Nigeria. Now, let me tell you, if your curriculum is very, very rich, it will be far and above what the common entrance will be asking your children. You can go and research this information I just gave you, and maybe you can get some of the past question of common entrance and check it out with. Go to any school that is very, very good. I mean international. So when I say international, I don't mean schools that are bearing international or Montessori. I mean schools that are practicing good curriculum, that understand what curriculum means to be global. You discover that what the children are really learning is not the exact thing per se that common entrance is actually going to ask. But if your curriculum is already rich and it's is robust, it's beautiful. There is nothing that the common entrance is going to be asking your children that will be new to them. Reason is that the curriculum would have even given them more and wider exposure. So back to that question, I don't really think it's about pushing the teacher to cover up curriculums or whatever. I think it's about motivating the teachers to give enough information in their classroom on every topic. Because you will agree with me that most of our topics in our curriculum is always asking us to do some topics for 2 weeks, some for 3 weeks. So if that is the case, then I think that a teacher can actually come sit down with a curriculum manager and there's a little bit of compression, but yet detailed information. So there wouldn't be that reason of just rushing through things and you're not even sure maybe the learners you are working with are even understanding what you're talking about. And that is why I love teachers to be able to test the understanding of children beyond examination. There are other ways you can actually test children's understanding of what you're teaching them, you know, beyond setting examination questions for them. I even discovered now that examination malpractices is not even only about public exam anymore. Even in our normal school setting, you discover that when a school is too examination focused, they end up even cheating right there without doing external exams like maybe WAEC, junior WAEC, or common entrance or whatever. So it's about helping practitioners to understand that the children understanding the concept of what you're teaching is what is most important and not just trying to beat up. And that's why when I go to schools, I'm always very particular about the number of subjects that teachers take per day. Some is not just reasonable. Some is not just attainable. You're setting goals that will never give you a very good, productive, you know, work in your school.
All right. Thank you very much, Ma, for that, for answering the question. So one of the things that I picked out from there is the fault is from the school owner, not from the teacher.
I don't think it's from the school owner per se. I think it's from all of us. From the government, our structure, the way we're structuring our education. And I'm sure that's one of the reasons why you're asking us to have this kind of a program, so that we can begin to think of mind shifts for everybody. School owners did not just bring their ideology from heaven, which is what the government actually table out for them that we are following and we're trying to meet up with. Only few of us that have a very deep understanding about what we're doing beyond, you know, just having a school, we've been teachers. We've been researchers, we've been a whole lot, that we then come into our own setting and we're trying to change things. So I would not agree with you that it's completely the fault of school owners. I think it's just all of us generally, and that's why I'm thanking you. Thank you so much, my wonderful brother, for putting up this program, so that we can begin to think of mind shift and we can begin to think of solutions for our nation, so that we can get children who are really learning and not just browsing over things to meet up with exams.
All right, thank you, ma'am, for that. All right, I have another question here from someone asked a question. Let me put it up on the screen. We have autistic children in the classroom. How do we manage those kind of children in the classroom?
Okay, now let me be very, very sincere with you, and I'm going to be blunt. Even when parents don't want to spend the extra money, not all teachers. In fact, if you have 100 teachers, maybe only 2 of them have enough information to deal with autistic children. Let's be realistic about that. So the truth is either a good school is allowing therapists to come to work with those children, or the parents themselves begin to organize different, you know, helping strategy for those child. Because look, let me be sincere with you. What you don't have, you can give. If a teacher doesn't have any information and knowledge for autistic children, it would be very unfair of you to expect that teacher to have results with such a child. That's my answer to that question, sincerely.
All right.
But we have experts who are therapists who are ready to come in. Yes, it's going to cost the parents an extra naira, but they should be ready to do that so that their children can have good results.
All right. Thank you, ma'am, for that answer. Well, we asked one of the questions. You said something here before. I wanted to ask a question. You said that one of the questions you ask your schools that you consult is, what is the age of the parents in your school, right?
Yes, what are their ages? So that that will give you an idea of which generation they belong to.
All right, so I think, because I wanted to ask before, what if the parents is not in line with this, doesn't know everything, anything about autistics, anything about it? So
the school have to educate them. Okay, now, sorry, let me tell you what happens in my school. Most times when parents bring their children for inquiry and I'm on sit, I happens to be around. Within 10, 15 minutes, I know a child who has a very high ADHD because of the way the child will be moving and the way he will be behaving around the whole of the reception and stuff like that. So I may not be able to place the percentage of the ADHD syndrome in that child, but I will have an idea that this child has ADHD. Of course, I'm able to also, you know, be able to discover a child that may be having a little bit problem with psycho children having this effect, attention seekers and stuff like that. I'm able to do that because I did a personal research on this because I just want to be sure. So sometimes you need to educate. So this is the point. I have almost two or three parents in my school that I was the one that helped them to discover that something is actually wrong with a child. And sincerely, I must tell you, it is not an easy thing. You see them, you know, at a very high level of denial. Some of them will scream at me. They talk to me as if, but of course, I've been able to understand that I'm also a mom. It's not easy to accept if you just discover that you have to handle some situation in your child, you know, beyond the normal, whatever. So I think a good school, an international school, and remember I said that an international school is not by name, it's by practice, should be able to educate parents about these autistic children, should be able to talk to them about the situation without really making them feel bad, and also rendering them help. Let them know that there is help and that it's not a dead sentence. That's the solution. Hello?
All right, another person asks a question here. What can a teacher do to assist kids that are good academically but have background issues, thereby being affected psychologically whenever in class? That's go on, man.
Okay, you said that's, I was about to ask you that this person would have given me a little bit of psychological. I would love to know what are the symptoms, because this psychological issue you're talking about is about three levels: Psycho 1, Psycho 2, Psycho 3, and children comes in with different level of those cycle into your classroom. You must have an idea, and the only way you can actually understand the level that child is struggling with is for you to look at the manifestation, because each of that level comes with different manifestation. I would have loved if this person can give me examples of what this child, he or she, is talking about, one or two things that the child is always doing in the classroom, then I'll be able to render help to that teacher. Just a guiding help. You might still need to see an expert. Like I told you, we have experts in this area who are also educators. I have some of them. I can't really fix the name of the company that works with because I partner with a lady who works with children on different issues like this in my own school. I allow her to come in and work, and we work together. We fill forms together. We do our feedback together. We do a whole lot of stuff together. And when we need to have sessions with parents, we agree on how we're going to go about it. So I don't know, maybe this person can give me one or two manifestations of this child, and then I'll be able to guide this person.
All right, I think she's typing on it. Let's just give her some few minutes to do that.
Minutes to type, okay.
All right, I have another question here.
Okay.
Right, talk about, in the beginning, we talked about having different equipment for different students, that the Gen Z's parents likes beautiful things. What can it do, let me say, they don't have the resources, but is their hard desire to do such a thing? Let me say, putting some artwork in the classroom, putting some pictures, how can they bring it down? That's putting up the minimum one in order to portray what you intended them to portray.
Okay, now the truth. I understand. My school is just 5 years. But sincerely, if you come around my school with all humility, you would think my school has been running for so many years. And I think that's just because, yes, when you come into my school, you know, for those who follow me, you would see some of the videos I was putting out yesterday when a particular set of schools came for a tour in my school. Now I'm going somewhere. You see, desires are awesome, but people don't really believe your desire, and they are not going to judge your brand based on desire. And I'm going to tell you why. Because desires are not seen, is within you. So you might have the vision and the dream, even if you are not at that level. Now, I was going somewhere when I was trying to talk about the story of my school. I would be deceiving myself that I have the kind of finances that school of 30 years or 25 years have. I don't have it. Let's not deceive ourselves. It's just 5 years. What I'm able to put up by the grace of God as a school is because by the grace of God, I have knowledge about this thing called school business. So now, the only way parents will be able to stay with you until you keep growing. For example, I can afford to have interactive board in all of my classroom now. But believe me, it is one of the powerful things I would do soon by the grace of God. But even when you come into my class, you won't even remember that I don't have an interactive board. That's the truth. Because the old shelf is filled up, yes, sir, with all humility. Because the old shelf is filled up with resources that children are engaged all through the day. You know, that they won't even remember that I don't have interactive board. So my advice for schools that are just starting up, that have desires, is let's even see a little bit of your desire. Get a bulletin board. Get papers. At least train your teachers to be able to do their bulletin board and to do it beautifully well. So when the Gen Z comes around you, even though you don't have everything in now, they will still respect the fact that as a growing school, you are able to put up these few things. I discovered that you're having a little bit of problem posting up my pictures or so. If not, I have thousands of pictures. Yeah, I have thousands of pictures that I can post to you on your WhatsApp page that you can post out for me up there.
Right, this is one of the pictures.
Okay.
Right.
Okay, I don't want to stress you. You know what you're going to do? I heard you talking about your WhatsApp group or whatever. So I'm just going to post more of those pictures and videos to you. Just try as much as possible to help me to post it to, you know, your followers. I'm sure many of them are with us this online. You know, because for me, I don't like when we do trainings like this, when we do webinar like this, and people are unable to go back into their setting and they are able to change at least one thing immediately. For me, that is education. For me, that is training. For me, that is the price to pay for data, to pay for time. So that's why I know that when I send you these pictures and these videos, believe me, you're going to be so excited to get the Nigerian schools to begin to think about coming up with it. No matter how little the fund is, it's just about you knowing that the parents you're serving want to see something that will excite their spirit and will touch their emotions to want to stay with you.
All right, Ma, I have been following you for quite some time now through your WhatsApp status, and I saw a lot of pictures. Like, asked myself, how do you get all these pictures? Because some of the school owners that I follow, they just post, I don't even know if they are school owners or not, because what they are posting is not even portraying if they are school owners or not. But just WhatsApp status every day, post not less than 10 pictures every day about your school, about your movement, everything, and they are beautiful pictures. And I also saw the tour that you also posted both on Facebook and on WhatsApp. And these are very good things. Like, I recommend any school that is watching this, take pictures. Like some of the schools that I work with, I recommend them, take pictures. You don't even need to hire a cameraman to do it. You have your phone, and I believe that you use your phone to snap all these pictures, right?
Yeah, my teachers, my team are powerful people. You know what I do? I make sure in my own little way, like I told you, it's a growing school. I don't have a fund that I can do like other schools that I wish to be like of, I follow a lot of schools I would love to be like in a few years to come. But in my own little way, I get my teachers to have few data. It can be 500 data, it can be 1,000, it depends on how much I can afford for that week. And so naturally, without really forcing them, it's part of our curriculum. You know, I still act as my manager for now, my curriculum manager in my school. So they know that for me, you have not taught in my school for that week. If you don't send me pictures, if you don't send me videos that I can actually look at and be able to say, wow, these children are learning and you're engaging them. So it's not just only me. Those pictures you're admiring comes from my teachers, come from my secretary, you know, anybody. Some of them, they are just going and they see a colleague doing something very fantastic and they bring out their phone and they snap, you know, to post to me so that I can see what this person is actually doing. It's part of our school culture. That's the truth. That's the truth. It's part of our school culture.
All right. So your school, you allow your teachers to operate their phones even at work.
Officially.
Yes, officially.
Yes.
But I think some teachers do neglect those opportunities. Let me say, they'll be using their phone. You know, you're in business, you're in a school, you're working, you are doing something that is not part of school. And I think it's like you have a policy on phone use.
Yeah, there's a culture. Yeah, there's a culture. Okay, now we have something we call the SMT time. Our SMT time is actually for our senior management team, where we download our feelings, our thinking, the kind of culture we're looking at. And then sometimes the SMT, you know, gives the freedom to me as a school consultant, you know, whatever you want to call me, as a director, to downflow some of this culture that I'm looking at. My teachers know that they can't post on their status during school hours. I will know. And they know. Not only will I know, I have people following them for me. They know. So sometimes when I tell them, why were you posting this by this time, by this time, by this time? Most times they are sober and they don't want it to repeat itself. Because of course, when we are talking about our KPI, our appraiser session for promotion and increase in tokens, you know, because we increase tokens, you can start with a little token, but your token grows in my scope. So those are the things that drops your tokens automatically when we know that you don't have control and discipline. So sincerely, nobody has a perfect school. I must be sincere with you. But the truth is, you cannot really, in this generation, you cannot really cut practitioner completely off from their phone. And I have a word I'm always saying to my teachers. If you have a friend, a family member, or anybody who can call you at work as a teacher and you are picking it, you are reducing who you are before that person. The person might not tell you, but the person is never going to take you serious and is never going to take the work you are doing seriously. So my teachers know. I'm not saying that I have a perfect team. But sincerely, you can come spend time in my school. It will be very difficult for you. Even though I don't have a policy of submitting your phone or whatever, it will be very difficult for you to catch my teachers with their phones. Sincerely, I don't mind if you want to come spend few hours in our school and see. Because it's a culture. And you know, culture is built by two things. What the leader models and what the leader permits. Once you miss that two things, you're going to have a very bad culture in your school. So they know that their phones is to hit their token, is to hit their appraiser performance for their KPI. So many of them, they know that these things, I wouldn't want anything that would drop me. And they know that I'm very accurate about catching them. Because many of them still don't know the trick I use in, you know, catching them. Quite funny. But I do. But sincerely, you can't cut teachers completely from their phone. They need to take, I call it catch memories pictures. Just like you said that you tell teachers in the schools you work with, there are some memories that once they are gone forever. You would never have them again. So it is very important. And one of the reasons why we respect the developed world is that they have memories. They have it in pictures. They have it in videos. They are talking to you about 50 years ago. They have memories to talk about what they are talking about. And so the respect we have for them is very high. So we need to also inculcate that into our education system and begin to get our practitioners to begin to think like that. And at the same time, making sure that they are responsible. Put in a token. And then they know that your token can either go up or down. Your appraisal for promotion or whatever can either go. You attach it and then you model it as a leader. you model it. Well, as a school consultant, the curriculum manager, you know, co-director, whatever that I am, my teachers still know that I'm very conscious of even how I use my phone around the school. They know. Because somehow I just want to model to them that, look, we're not going to be careless with those things that then you're getting carried away with your phone and the children are getting injured and we are getting a whole lot of complaint from our parents. And you know that your class, your person, is either adding to our brand or deducting from our brand perception. So you must understand that even though it is not your school, you are a brand in our brand. So they understand all those things because it's something we consistently talk about. I love meetings. Everybody who has ever worked with me know when I finish with you now, I'm still going to an online meeting, even though my teachers are on break, you know, their balanced life session, but still they know I'm still going to keep talking to them about the issues that would affect our brand perception for the community where we are, especially because we're serving parents that are Gen Z, very, very exposed, and they know what they want. So we can take it lightly.
All right. Thank you very much, Ma. And sorry, Ma, for taking much of your time. One of the person I asked about autistic students have listed some of the symptoms in the comment section. Let me just put it up on the screen. Okay, this is it. Like every day, the child either leaves book at home. He is found bullying his mates, not ready to practice in the class activities. So these are some of the negligent or some of the...
All right. Okay. So, sir, the truth is that school needs to have a session with this child's parent. I have different sessions. I have my form that I fill for my sessions with parents. For example, when we find out that children bullies, we try to check their records. We try to track them down. What time did they actually got admitted into our school? And from that time to this moment, how many times have we had bully sessions with them? And we need to talk to them about their reactions and emotions. And then it's like a graph that we draw to, you know, kind to track down that child. So with that, we begin to know and have an idea of what is actually happening at home. But sincerely, I think this child that this practitioner is talking about, the parent needs to be called for a session, not to condemn them, but to reason together with them. I did one yesterday with a father, and you'll be shocked at how he himself was able to discover what the problem is. And we started talking together on solutions. So please let this practitioner discuss with the school consultant or whoever is working with them, and then let them plan to have a session with this parent so that they can begin to see how to help this child, because this child is actually bringing an extension of home experience into that classroom. The teacher will not be able to help this child alone.
All right, thank you very much, Ma. One last question. I believe everybody is getting some knowledge from what I'm seeing in the comment section. So one of the school owners here is asking, how can we make, okay, look at the comments on the screen. How can we make and practice as international school, Ma? Okay, I believe that your section you have already dished out many things, many points, some of the things that schools need to know. But I just want you to just give one or two steps or a few things listed in a tabular form. Let me say, just give us one or a few things that the school have to do. Maybe the school didn't get everything. Just two things that the school can just practice.
All right. Let's start by saying, make sure that the school environment is neat. At least I'm not asking you to spend too much money except for getting a cleaner and then selling the culture of neatness. As I am in my school, I pick papers. Even though we have a culture where we get our children together and we call it the trash session with them, the trash session with our children is getting the ideology into them that you can throw papers anywhere in our compound. You see, when a school is neat, even when you don't have all the gadgets or you don't have anything, it speaks volume for parents when they just walk into your school from the way everything looks very neat. So at least start from there. Get a neat school. Let your school be neat. Get everybody to have a culture of the consciousness that our school needs to be neat. And it's not just the work of a cleaner alone. It is everybody's responsibility in the team to make sure that our school is neat. So at least we can start from there. Then the next thing, you know, as an international school, is number two, try to get, no matter how little, resources. It doesn't have to be brand new. If I don't have the fund to import materials now from China or from the UK or from whatever, at least there are good, fairly used markets that I can go that have a lot of resources that my children can work with. Lots of resources. I don't know, from that video clip you said you saw my status, you can see the way I was actually showing the video of my resource room. That room you saw is called the resource room in our school. And there is virtually no resource you can find. Teachers know they have to come in. Once they have a topic, they come into that room to come and pick things that will get them to engage the children in their classroom. So it's not as expensive as we think sometimes. It's just about we wanting what we want. And we just don't want our school to bear the name International, Global, or Montessori, or Ratio, or, you know, Asia school. We want it to be real in practice. So you begin to look for solution. Recently, I told a client a market to go to get some stuff. And when she got those things, she sent me the video of what she was able to get. I said, that's it. That's the spirit. You don't have to bring it from the UK. If you don't have opportunity to go for conferences like Coach Anito, at least, Mrs. Ayoade, but at least you can always get what you want around here. It's just about you wanting, knowing what you want.
Wow. All right, so thank you very much, Ma, for the wonderful section.
Thank you for having me. Thank you so much for having me. Yes, I'm so happy. I'm so happy to be doing this with you. Thank you. Thank you for the privilege. All right, then.
Thank you very much, Ma. See
Bye.
You.
Bye. Bye-bye.
All right, thank you very much for joining us in this media edition of the Smart School Growth Academy. And I believe you grabbed some knowledge and get some few things you need to practice in your school in order to navigate your way in a world of changing education. All right, so if I've said something before, if you're not in our WhatsApp group, do well to register. If you did not register, but if you have registered for this event and you submitted your right email, you'll be sent an email to join our WhatsApp platform in order to receive the recording, the replay of this section in your email. All right, do well to register. So in the next few minutes, I'm going to talk about integrating technology into your school. As the first speaker said that, the first and second speaker said that you can start up with anything and you don't need to break the bank in order for you to start doing what you need to do to be an international school. Integrating technology in your school is also very, very necessary. Just like the previous speaker said something about beautifying your school, showcasing pictures and so on. Let's start from the basic one that doesn't cost to anyone. All of you have WhatsApp, all of you have Facebook, all of you have Instagram and Twitter. All these platforms are absolutely free of charge for you to have. Is your school on Facebook? If I go on Facebook, type the name of your school, Royal View Academy, Treasure Near School, Enugu. All these schools, is your school found on Facebook? Facebook is a very, very good platform to market your school. Showcase what you have. Start from, don't be hiding. There's a one particular quote that says perfection is an enemy of success. If you are trying to be perfect in whatever you are doing, just like the previous speaker is showcasing her picture, if she waits in order to get a digital camera, in order to get a photographer to be doing all this, in order to edit the pictures, do all these things and so on and so forth, it's going to weigh you down. It's going to weigh you down. So you have to start from what you have. Facebook is a free platform. Instagram is a free platform. Your school, your fellow parents, you can add them in a WhatsApp community and be sharing some of the things you videoed or some of the things you snap. These are one of the ways to integrate technology in your school. Then talking about Google. Google is another place, Google Map. If I search for your school, one of the schools that I visited last year to market our software, I have searched through Google. Their name, and I was trying to locate it. It wasn't found on Google. It wasn't found on Instagram. It wasn't found on Facebook. But if when I visited this, it was a very big school and a very beautiful school. But they are not searchable on Google. So some of these things, just create an account, go to Google, create an account on Google, go to Google Map, create an account on Google Map, and let it be pointed in your school. So that if anybody wants to visit your school, they can easily navigate their way to your school. Then another thing that you can also do in order to integrate technology in your school, she said about smart board. But if you don't have smart board, there are other equipment. There's one tablet that was posted in my WhatsApp platform about it's a tablet that enables students to write. She sold it at the rate of 5,000 per one. She's in Lagos State, I think so. One of our users. So all these platforms, all these tablets is also necessary in your school. But if you cannot do it, start with what you have. The main thing is start from somewhere. Then let me talk about Smart School. Smart School is a school management software company based in Enugu State, Nigeria. We help schools to automate their processes, automating of student results, creating of website, attendance, so many things, CBT examination, and the rest of them, your school fees payment. All these things are features of Smart School software. I'm going to talk about these in our WhatsApp platform in subsequent time, due to we have exceeded the time that we have for it. All right, this is it for now. So in the comment section, drop your biggest take home, drop your appreciation message to all our speakers, drop the things that you noted down so that everybody can share from what you learned. See you on the next edition. All right, I want to also apologize. We have the third speaker, but she sent a message that she had an emergency, that she won't be able to join us live. So I'm going to communicate with her to fix another day, probably on Saturday next week. We are still going to go live here so that she can teach us about parents, how to manage parents. That's the topic she's going to teach us. So see you by next Saturday. And if you're not in our WhatsApp platform, do well to check your email after this section. And if you are registered, if you are not registered, use the registration link or the comment section to register. All right. Thank you very much all for joining us in this wonderful edition. I believe you have gained the knowledge you need in order to navigate your way in a world of changing education. All right. See you in the next video. See you on the next thread section. See you on the WhatsApp platform. Our Facebook, if you have not followed our Facebook, do well to follow us on Facebook. We're also on Instagram, Smart School Software Engine. You can follow us everywhere. Thank you for joining us live. Thank you very much, and I appreciate it. Do have a lovely evening. See you next time.